I personally think that it has been somewhat deceptive and misleading for Southern Seminary to invite women to come there and receive theological training under the delusion that they're going to be able to serve as pastors in Southern Baptist churches. It ain't going to happen.
When he said women to keep their tongues quiet in the church, I believe that in all ways.
My beliefs in women in the ministry are basically come from that Jesus chose all apostles and they're men. I don't really know why I believe so strongly, and I guess from the background of how I grew up, but I just believe that women need to sit in the pews.
The scriptures do not support it. If you look at 1 Timothy or you look at any of the other scriptures talking about pastors, you'll never see it referring to a lady.
That's me in the corner. That's me in the spot.
A vigil. I pray it is not a requiem for an institution that we love, to whom so many of us are indebted. Southern has been prophetic at times, never often enough, and usually it has suffered for it. When Martin Luther King Jr. was invited to preach here, some racist donors were offended, and the seminary lost money. Money well spent.
I have friends who say they simply cannot bear to walk on campus. They love this school so much, but to go back and experience the pervasive atmosphere of fear and intimidation and depression that is there is simply more than they can handle emotionally. It is a sad occasion.
Wherever you stand, that everyone can see that people have been hurt and angered, and that's, no one's happy about that.
And now, with the departure of my gentle colleague, Pam Scalise, my forced resignation, and Denise Massey's undaunted claim to pastoral calling, the School of Theology is without a tenured woman, and probably will be, as long as the misogynistic forces are unabated.
And if you believe that pastors can be women, then you need to go somewhere else, because we're not going to believe it. You see, so the gauntlet is down. It's not going to be changed. You see, so if professors believe that, then it's our job to get them out of here.
Paul and Silas were bound in jail, had no money for to go their bail. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on, hold on.
The Bible is crystal clear that in the Church of God, that women are not to have the position of ruling and teaching over men. I don't know all the reasons why God did that. I have some ideas, but I don't know all the reasons why he did, but he said it. And I can't be committed to the authority of God's revealed word and take a position other than what his word takes.
Hold on.
One of the main qualifications which would, to me, hinder a woman is where it's set forth in 2 Timothy, where God has said that the pastor should be the husband of one wife. So if he placed that in his word, then it must be very important. And it's kind of hard for me to realize a woman being the husband of one wife.
One of the proof texts that those who are opposed to women as ordained pastors uses is the New Testament passage, which says that if an elder or a bishop are translated in Baptist life to mean pastor, he should be the husband of one wife. It's by implication that it's a male. It does not say that women cannot serve as pastors, but it says if a man serves as pastor, this is what he is supposed to be, along with a lot of other guidelines that appear in that same passage. This is, to my way of thinking, a rather weak proof text, but it is the most popular proof text that is used.
We are blessed with deeply dedicated and talented women in ministry in nearly every capacity that you can imagine, with a single exception of senior pastor or male pastor or leadership position in the church as the senior, we might call the senior pastor.
Information, Barbara Galloway. Dessert party, Gwen Gillis. Registration, Edna Gray.
Well, being a woman, I'm for however they feel like God has called them, and I just don't limit where God calls. Never have, and I don't think I ever would.
There were about 800 pastors there. They were seated around tables, so it looked like, you know, just a sea of men. And it wasn't a problem for me. You know, I stood up to speak. But when I did, I don't know how many, it looked like half the audience, it probably wasn't that many, but they got up and turned their chairs around and put their backs to me.
What I would say to a woman who senses that call is that I believe perhaps she has misunderstood God's call in her life. Now, that misunderstanding may be because there is this debate going on, and a great many people are advocating women in the role of senior pastor.
People in our churches want us to live a certain way. People in our denomination want us to be a certain way. But I ask you, if we are so busy being the ministers that everyone else tells us to be, well then in whose name do we really serve?
God has established the echelon or the chain of command or the order of creation. And if we're going to accept the God of the Bible, then we have to accept His Word and the chain of command that He's established, which has nothing to do with superiority, inferiority, intellect in any way, but simply the fact that as a result of the fall, man makes his bread by the sweat of his brow, and woman has her place under man according to Scripture.
The thing that I think is so important in understanding Genesis and what Genesis says about humankind is the use of the word Adam, the Hebrew word Adam, which in Genesis 1 is shown clearly to mean both male and female. It's not a gender-specific term at all. The text says God created Adam in His image. In the image of God, He created them. And it makes it clear that it's male and female both that are being created. So to use that kind of a text as something to make one gender over another or a subordination role is just misinterpreting the text, I think. Now, in Genesis 2, a lot of people feel that we have a different situation because we have the creation of man first and the reference to women only at the end of the text being created. Well, one thing that I note is if we follow the same pattern of Genesis 1, that would mean that the most important thing is created last. In Genesis 1, it is Adam, humankind, male and female, is created last and is the climax of creation. If that were so, that would mean in Genesis 2, we would have to say that woman is the climax of creation by being the last one created.
Why do we raise such a ruckus over a person, a woman, being a senior pastor? Why don't we raise a ruckus about, why don't we hold to slavery? The Bible teaches slavery. Adultery was a capital crime. These people say they take the Bible literally, verbatim, et literatim, et punctuatum. Why don't they apply capital punishment to adultery? That'd take care of the population.
We're all poets. We don't say to our sweetheart when we're courting her, look what a wonderful way in which the earth is rotating on its axis so that the refraction of the sun's rays makes it appear that the sun is setting. This is not very romantic. We say, look at the sun setting. We know better. There's poetic language in the Bible, too. But where the Bible speaks clearly, then it is without error philosophically, scientifically, theologically, historically. That's what we mean by that.
You know that when God says, and the Bible says, man should not kill or something like that, it's obviously generic language of mankind. However, when he says the husband of one wife, the words are very specific. It's the relationship between a husband and a wife. So that cannot be humankind in general, because husband and wife are gender-specific terms.
They forget the tradition of Jesus, who commissioned women among the disciples to be proclaiming witnesses. They forget the numerous examples of women who function in apostolic ways in the Pauline epistles. And then they forget the larger theological issues that all are one in Christ Jesus, and that the church is a body of many parts, surely women participant in the body of Christ. And so the larger themes of the New Testament, they try to cancel out by one or two selective texts that would obliterate the propriety of women serving as spiritual leaders, authority, pastors, whatever.
You see, what they do, they pick and choose different passages to support their own prejudices. And apparently, there's a prejudice toward women.
Hold on.
At this point, I would not be a member of a church or go to a church where a woman was a senior pastor.
One of the best things I ever did was agree to serve as a rural pastor. I was finishing my PhD program, and I had sent resumes all over, and nobody was quite ready to hire a woman in Baptist colleges or seminaries. And so a small rural church called me to be their pastor. A funny thing happened in the nursery, but I think it is illustrative of how people really process the issue of women in ministry. Whenever the little girls and little boys would go back during the worship service to have children's church, the little girls would never let the little boys be the preacher. What they had witnessed, of course, was me being the preacher. So Ida B., great name, the children's worker would say, now girls, little boys can be preachers too. But those little girls weren't convinced, because what they had witnessed was what they believed to be true. And I have the perception that so many people in churches have simply never witnessed other than men serving in leadership roles. If they had, that would make the argument much better than all my pontifical lectures, I think.
Oh, God, give us some men who have a positive attitude, who believe if God be for us, who can be against us?
It takes time to keep people down. And if you're going to try to keep over 50% of a group down, it takes a lot of energy to do that. That could better be used to building rather than destroying.
Freedom's name is mighty sweet. Black and white are gonna meet. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on, why don't you hold on?
Baptists were the people who claimed that ordinary folks ought to be able to run their own churches, ought to be able to decide who their pastors would be, ought to be able to gather together in community and interpret the Bible for themselves without having the interpretation imposed from outside the community.
We came out of the dissenters of England, who resisted King George and Archbishop Laud. They came to this country seeking ways to express their own religious beliefs. Out of that Puritan background came what is regarded as the beginning of the Baptist movement in America, with Roger Williams, who had to flee from Puritan persecution in Massachusetts and was protected by the Indians during a very cold winter and came back and set up Rhode Island, which was the first experiment in true religious liberty in America.
Women have always had more of a place in Baptist life than they would have in, for instance, a more established kind of hierarchical denomination, where there were lots of hoops to jump through and lots of official credentials and so forth. Where you got a religious group that really trusts the people and trusts the people to listen to the calling of God and listen to God's leadership in their lives, God's likely to do unlikely things.
Following Williams, there was John Leland and Isaac Backus, who along with James Madison and Thomas Jefferson assured what's now the First Amendment to the Constitution of the United States. That was a Baptist contribution. What I've often said is the most singular, greatest contribution the Baptists have made to political science, namely the notion of religious liberty and the separation of church and state in the United States.
Baptists are most Baptist-like when they're in the minority, but beginning in the 1950s, and maybe even before then, but at least since the 1950s, Baptists in the southern United States have become such a dominant force that they were no longer in the minority.
Now, instead of defending religious liberty as a human right, we have people who are denying religious liberties in the name of power. We used to focus what we think of as power or authority in God and in the individual conscience as led by God and Scripture. And now we focus power in the religious leader who has a place of leadership, and they're supposed to be able to dictate the terms for belief and faithful response to other believers in the churches. The Southern Baptist Convention is the single largest Protestant denomination in the United States. It numbers nearly 40,000 churches that cooperate with the Southern Baptist Convention and counts nearly 15 million members of those churches. Now, if the leaders could get everybody to cooperate with and agree with the radical right agenda, that is a powerful voting bloc and becomes terribly influential to any congressperson or person in government.
The top six leaders in American government are Baptist, Clinton and Gore and Gingrich, and of course Strom Thurmond, and Jesse Helms, who heads up the Foreign Relations Committee and so forth. These are all Baptist.
What is being presented as the gospel by some is not the gospel of Jesus Christ, but another gospel. Gospel wedded to an American nationalistic political agenda, and it is being preached and promoted in ways not consonant with the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Fiercely independent Baptists discovered they could do some things better together than they could separately, so they decided they'd form the Southern Baptist Convention.
One of the reasons it was formed was to do mission work, to send people to places where people hadn't heard the good news.
Now tomorrow we begin a very historic Southern Baptist Convention. It's our 150th. You have an opportunity to be a part of something very, very special.
Women, of course, were also very important in the organizational structure of the Southern Baptist Convention. It's really out of the kind of grassroots organizing that's represented by the Women's Missionary Union that you get the infrastructure out of which a denomination can be built.
The Southern Baptist Convention is a democratic process. A church that gives $250 to any SBC agency cause can send a messenger. The most messengers that any single church can have is 10.
The democratic process worked quite well for Southern Baptists for about 130 years, But in the mid-70s, Paul Pressler and Paige Patterson analyzed how to take over the convention, and it was Paul Pressler, a very brilliant judge from Houston, Texas, who decided that if you could capture the presidency and control it for enough years, you could ultimately control the whole convention.
Initially, a group of about 35 or 40, a couple of guys from each state, each Southern Baptist state, met in Atlanta, right here at the old Ramada Inn out at the airport with Judge Pressler and I. We shared with them the situation, and we told them what we had discovered about how it could be changed.
They elected a conservative president, and they realized that the president has phenomenal appointive powers. So if you could get your person, your man, of course, in as president of the convention, then you can control the Committee on Nominations, which eventually control all the trustee boards of all the agencies and institutions of the Southern Baptist Convention.
In 1979, we had the first step toward the election of a president who would appoint people that would carry out the agenda of the fundamentalist takeover.
Nominated for terms expiring in 1998, Fred Caffey, Morris Denman, Michael Harris, P.A. Stevens, and John Pennington, with John Pennington replacing Bob Wagner, who is retiring from the board.
In 1984, the Southern Baptist Convention passed a resolution on women in leadership positions, which basically said that women could not hold leadership positions in the church, that it was inappropriate. And it cited lots of reasons, one of which was that Eve was the first in the fall, which one of the student observer replied, that's a long time to hold a grudge.
The conclusion tells the local church to exclude certain persons for consideration as pastor. Look at it there. For pastor and leadership, there are certain persons that should be excluded. That is directing, that is speaking to, that is dealing with something that is the affair of the local church entirely. Who the church calls, who their leaders are. We have the Bible, we have the Holy Spirit, and we have the free, autonomous local church to decide those matters.
I appreciate Dr. Dehoney's pointing this out to us. However, I do not find the resolution instructs the churches, and I rule that it is not proper.
When I arrived early at the hall, I asked a person, is there any way I can help? And I was told, be sure not to speak from a microphone because you're a woman, and if you speak, then right away things are against you.
Who else tries to have an open town meeting with 20,000 people, let alone 45,000 like we had one time? And so you have X amount of business that you have to get through, which puts a time limitation on you. And yes, only so much discussion is going to get done. And part of the secret to the whole thing is that if everybody that's got something they want to quibble about on this thing goes to a microphone, then one of the things it suffers is the most serious item under discussion often doesn't get discussed much.
I have a point of personal privilege. I wish to state now, my church will
not be bound.
My name is Kenneth Burke, East Washington Heights Baptist Church.
All right.
A point of personal privilege. My church will not be bound by any action of this convention condemning the ordination of women as deacons. We have
Brother
women
Kenneth,
as
you're
deacons,
out of order.
And we will not
Brother
be
Kenneth,
bound by any...
You're out of order. We know that. You're not telling us anything we don't know.
I have never been able to figure out why women are being so opposed, and being a WMU person, I really feel like that I guess when it all boils down to it, I feel like it's a thing of power and control.
Somebody is always in charge, and those somebodies always have beliefs, and those somebodies who have those beliefs always push them.
All those opposed, would you please let it be known by raising your ballots?
The very processes of democracy have been used against the real objectives of democracy. Here in Atlanta in 1995, you did not see debate. You heard a very select committee offer their report and present it as God-given and not to be challenged. Someone used the phrase to me, we're having edicts offered.
Fellow messengers, I've been on this platform for 13 years. The amendment clearly lost.
Also, I think the current leadership was very, very clever in the way that they manipulated the issues to make the average Baptist feel that if he questioned anything that the denomination or his preacher, quote, quote, ever raised, he was being disloyal to his faith. I think he really was made to feel that his loyalty to Christ might be in question.
And I believe when we violate it, we not only are disobedient to the Word of God and to God Himself, but that we risk a great deal of blessing and the power of God as we give up what He has ordained as the way He would like His church to operate.
Victory! Oh, victory!
Along the way, it's been step by step. Every agency has fallen to fundamentalist control as soon as there was a simple majority of fundamentalists on the Board of Trustees. So what is an ideal democratic process worked against the health and well-being of Southern Baptists? The very thing that made us what we were historically turned out to be our downfall.
What we've seen in the Southern Baptist Convention, it seems to me, is very much a part of this much larger movement around the world.
And that's a shift away from what I would consider an affirmation of equality and diversity to a reestablishment of old patriarchal lines of authority. And it's confined within a description of family values and other issues that can't be rejected by people because no one would be against apple pie and mom.
What's going on in terms of subordinating women in our tradition is happening in others.
I contend that fundamentalism is not a religion. It's a mindset, it's a worldview, it's a lifestyle, and you can apply it to economics, you can apply it to politics, you can apply it to religion, and we're seeing that happen. The Southern Baptist Convention is a microcosm of the fundamentalist technique agenda imposed upon a religious body in the United States.
This is the Grand Jewel, the Mother Seminary, founded 1859, shortly after the convention was birthed itself. This institution came into being in Greenville, South Carolina. This institution has always been thought of as the academic leader of Southern Baptist seminaries. And in many respects, the will to conquer it was larger.
Southern was the last of the great institutions among Southern Baptists to be taken over because it was known as a liberal seminary, that is, committed to autonomy and individual rights and separation of church and state and things like that.
it's important for Southern Baptists to understand that it is the responsibility of the trustees to guarantee theological fidelity. Now, the trustees have sought to do that in several ways. The most important way is in the election of Al Mohler.
Without apology, we are hoping that in the classroom, we are expecting that all those who are added to this faculty will uphold the position that the pastorate is a male office. And though we support women in ministry, we do not believe women should serve as pastor.
From my personal standpoint, we could not have done better in getting a president. Al Mohler is tops in my view.
When I met Dr. Mohler in 1984, he was in the president's office serving as a special assistant to Roy Honeycutt. Al was the epitome of all that Southern Seminary meant, and in relation to women in ministry, Southern Seminary was very supportive at that time of women in ministry and various leadership positions within the church.
At the Southern Baptist Convention in 1984, I believe it was, they passed a resolution prohibiting women from being pastors. Why, he started a protest movement of his own right here on this campus against that kind of thing. It was published in the Courier Journal.
For all around us, we see the ruins of once great churches and once great denominations, which in the name of tolerance and modernity and inclusivity forfeited their integrity.
Coming to the New Orleans Convention, whispering to me in the press room on Tuesday morning, knowing that I was a moderate, that it did not look good for our side. And then after we had been defeated at that point and Roy Honeycutt declared that any politicizing from our part was over, Al Mohler returned to Georgia and his editorials took a hard right and began to become very political and very fundamentalist.
There's this great story that always gets told about Southern Seminary that you may have noticed while you were on campus that there's not a cross on top of the chapel. In fact, there's a weather vane on top of the chapel, and the story goes that every morning everyone has to go out on the lawn to see which way the theological winds are blowing, so they'll know what to teach that day. And Al Mohler, in my assessment, pretty much personifies that story.
Dr. Al Mohler is a man who lives his convictions with courage.
For me, having known Al and watched this transformation of Al, when other people would call him a fundamentalist, I would correct them and say he's an opportunist, that there's a difference of conviction.
Well, it's very simple. I think he wanted to be president of Southern Baptist Seminary. I think he wanted to be a leader in the denomination. And to be a leader in the denomination, you've got to think, you've got to act, you've got to do what the leadership of the convention requires.
Well, that's apocryphal and untrue. However, it's a very difficult thing to respond to, other than to say anyone who operates in that kind of motive doesn't deserve to be in service or leadership anywhere. And if that's what brought me here, it's really untenable when one considers the course of events over recent years.
I just wanted to say a word to Dr. Mohler. In an age where we talk about what we believe, I appreciate so much the great stand of Dr. Mohler in these past days as he's led the Southern Seminary. I know that it's not been an easy time. The transition's always difficult. But Dr. Mohler, you continue to stand upon the truth of the Scripture, and we as a Southern Baptist Convention will affirm you. Thank you so much.
So I've been very, very, very clear about my own convictions, and I will always be just that.
It is my prayer, hope, and desire that God will do a new thing at Southern, where leaders lead by example and not by edict.
Policies were approved that have to do with contemporary social issues, abortion, homosexuality, the Bible. And in addition to that, there was a policy approved which, in effect, in common everyday language, is a gag order.
When a new faculty member comes on at Southern Seminary, he or she, and it will probably be he henceforth forevermore, has to say, I believe that the Bible is inerrant. I have to believe that abortion in every case is a sin, that homosexuality is a sin. I have to believe that women cannot be called to the role of senior pastor. That's the rhetoric. They really mean any kind of pastor.
A person may agree to all 20 articles in the abstract and be willing to sign the covenant renewal agreement, but if that person is pro-women in the pastorate, that person will not be hired at Southern Seminary.
Now, can you teach these things in Southeastern Seminary or Southern Seminary? Sure. You can talk about them, you can teach them all you want to. Can you advocate them and not get in trouble? No, you can't, because the convention has spoken clearly on the issue. So the difference is between what you teach and what you advocate. There are a lot of people out there who believe women are perfectly qualified to be pastors of churches. If our students graduate and they're unaware of that, they're ignorant. They're not well educated. They've got to know, and they've got to know it fairly presented. But then we do show them why the scripture shows the other thing to be true.
Southern Baptist leadership right now, the conservative leadership, want seminary education simply to repeat or inculcate what they already think, which is really an evisceration of the role of theological education.
These people believe in thought control, and if you don't conform with them and believe what they believe, you are out. O-U-T, out.
I think the administration is making a very clear message, and it's not just a message to us as students, to faculty, but it's a message to the church at large, to the world. It's setting up a hierarchical standard of men can serve in the senior pastorate, women cannot. It is part of an oppressive patriarchal system that we have grown up in, that Jesus came to stand against, to say, we are all equal, there is no male, no female, and we continue to make such statements as the Board of Trustees, as a higher institution, academic institution. We continue to give the message to women in our local churches that you are not as good as a man, that you cannot serve in a position a man can stand in, that you're not quite as much like God as a man is like God. And that is the message it gives, and it's wrong.
To follow up on that, just in closing, but aren't you saying it's okay for you to disagree as long as you don't state that disagreement publicly?
There are ways to disagree and to work through matters. I know you ladies and gentlemen are with the press. I appreciate your job and your responsibility. We should be working through this problem today, not in front of microphones and cameras, but in closed doors as faithful men and women of God.
What I want to know is the president ever wrong? Is the administration ever wrong? And is the Board of Trustees ever wrong? And are they Christian enough to admit it publicly and admit how they're wrong? Now, the idea of going to a brother or sister face to face is a good idea. The Bible also tells us that what is hidden will be brought to light. And if one has not done anything wrong, then one should not be ashamed of having it all shown to the world.
We all fall into the fateful trap of attending church with people that look like us, sound like us, believe like us, and think like us. And if we're never put in an environment where those patterns of thought are challenged, then we don't know what we don't know. We don't understand what we don't really see about other people.
And why should Southern Seminary be expected to bend and modify and change our confessional document to allow someone's own personal perspective to have place at the institution? We just simply are not going to do that.
Any objections to this? If not, and you favor the resolutions as they've been presented to us by the Resolutions Committee, should that be known, please, by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, by like sign.
It was just stated in the meeting that what had been done in grace and with indignity. Grace is unmerited love. As I see the tears of men and women students, of men and women faculty, I stood by an administrator with tears in his eyes in the press conference. I want you to know that it's hard, hard for me to understand that what's been done.
It has been said that Lottie Moon was probably the best educated woman of the South in the 19th century. She went as a missionary to China. She did not seek ordination. She's never filled the pastoral role. But Molly Marshall is probably the 20th century counterpart of Lottie Moon. Molly is very brilliant, very well educated, very personable, very influential when she speaks. There's a certain kind of magnetism and dynamic qualities in Molly Marshall's life. Therefore, she constitutes a very real threat and an issue not to be ignored anytime you deal with this issue. I think she was made to be uncomfortable on the faculty at Southern because she was a threat to some of the men, probably starting with the president of the seminary.
And an institution also has to decide, and it's not just an option, it's a responsibility, how much diversity can be tolerated or should be tolerated within its parameters.
I was informed this past summer in June, after the Southern Baptist Convention had convened, that I needed either to be prepared to resign or the president would press charges for my dismissal at the fall trustee meeting. I asked what the charges were, and our system is such that you don't have to say what they are until you actually file them. And so the allegation, it appeared, was that I was teaching outside our confessional document, which is the abstract of principles. I'd only had one conversation with the president about my teachings. On March 16, I spent an hour and a half with him in the presence of the academic vice president, David Dockery, and he questioned me about my writings, whether or not I perceived that they were within the abstract. I said I did. No student has ever accused me of teaching outside the abstract. He was rather noncommittal. He didn't say, "You're outside the abstract." Evidently, it was just an investigation. A couple of months later, I hadn't heard anything, and the vice president told me that the president had evidently assumed that I was outside the abstract and that I needed to be disposed of.
The problem with Molly Marshall was the gospel of Jesus Christ. The problem was she didn't believe Article 5 on election. The problem was she didn't believe Article 4 on the providence of God. The problem was she didn't believe in the inerrancy of Scripture according to Article 1 on inspiration. The problem was she didn't believe the article on God. She referred to him as our sister spirit, as God our mother.
I was witnessing when I first came to Southern the beginning of a very well-orchestrated smear campaign. That's what it appeared to be. I got anonymous bulletins and newsletters and one small booklet in my mailbox. All of it was directed at how Dr. Marshall was not suitable as a professor, as certainly as a professor at Southern.
I was given an ultimatum. You either resign by August 19 or the following week the president will file charges. And then there's a process for a faculty member to be dismissed. It's basically a heresy trial. I was told by the vice president that they had the votes and the will to fire me. This is prior to any investigation of my writing, so it seemed to me like a kangaroo court.
The intention behind the actions taken was to make clear the direction of the seminary and the resolve of the governing board with the administration to make those changes that are necessary in order to move the seminary forward in the future.
Excerpts from her class lectures were put into booklets, one of this little booklet that I had, and pamphlets, and it became obvious that somebody was taping lectures and then sending them to some central place and having it distributed and recorded. And everything appeared to be taken out of context, just focusing on how unsuitable she was, that she was outside not just Baptist belief, whatever general Baptist belief is, but she was also outside of Christian belief.
And so I decided, given the ultimatum, there was really no future for me here. I think it is my stand on women in ministry as much as any so-called theological aberrancy that made the president want to dispose of me. And he did it in a ruthless manner.
Every other kind of institution and corporation does the same thing. When a local school board hires an administrator, they give him certain parameters within which to move and do his thing. When he goes beyond that, then he has to face the music. And the same thing was true with Molly Marshall. She believed in post-mortem opportunities for salvation. She said God might be at work in the other major religions, bringing men to himself. Well, while there are people in our country, in this democracy, who might subscribe to that view, Southern Baptists do not subscribe to that view. We believe in the exclusivity of the gospel of Jesus Christ in society for salvation. There is no other way.
Dr. Molly Marshall, who was coerced to resign as a faculty member. The spring before, she had been selected for a Teaching Excellence Award and was one of the most loved professors here at the seminary. Her dismissal caused great grief and anger among our student body. When it became a reality that Dr. Marshall was forced out, it really became a reality for me that I was also being personally attacked by the school, by the Board of Trustees, by the Southern Baptist Convention leaders. When they said, she is not welcome here, they also said, I'm not welcome here. And that was a very enraging position to be in. You know, I felt as if I was being told that I was some subhuman, you know, character.
This is a very important moment for the Mother Seminary of Southern Baptists, and I believe as we come to this critical time in history, is a critical moment for all of Southern Baptist theological education. You need to know what is taking place. It is change, but it is not change for the sake of change, but change for the cause of truth, of the gospel, integrity, and confession. Such change is costly, but the failure to make such change is more costly still. It is to forfeit our calling and our convictions.
I run this race, oh glory, I run this race, 'cause I know.
We are in a battle for the minds of Southern Baptists. Right now, the fundamentalist, conservative, new right, political type Baptists are in control of the offices, agencies, and commissions of the Southern Baptist Convention. They likely will never give that up. That does not mean that they'll be able to control the consciences and minds of all Southern Baptists. And that's our hope, is that Baptists will genuinely be Baptists and will not accept the tyranny of the mind and spirit that fundamentalist political types are attempting to impose upon them.
Thank you all very much.
Consider